mean, the on the representation theory of finite groups, tomorrow there will be an exercise session. And so let me recall what I was doing. I will finish the proof of the main results today. So recall that there were four theorems in this series of lectures. Theorem 1 and 2 have been proved already. Theorem 3 says that if we have two representations of a group, finite group G, then they are isomorphic if and only if their characters are isomorphic. Now the characters are actually the same. They are functions on the ring of class functions, which is denoted by C of G, where G is a finite group. And theorem 4 said that the set of characters of the irreducible representations is an orthonormal basis for this vector space. This is as a vector space is C to the M, where M is the number of conjugacy classes, and this is an orthonormal basis. Because we have a scalar product on this space. So those were the two theorems. And in order to prove this, I had introduced a representation space associated to two representations. If V and W are G representations, then we have HOM VW, which can be viewed as a space of matrices. This is also a G. Is also a G representation. And there was a formula for the action if sigma is in G and if F is in here, then sigma F is also in this space of homomorphisms, and the formula to compute it is the following, that sigma F of a vector V and V is equal to sigma applied to F applied to sigma inverse of V. This was the formula, and this works for every V in V. That was the formula, and one of the consequences of this definition is that the G invariance of this space, so which is denoted by HOM VW, this G is precisely equal to the set of G equivariant maps from V to W. So these are the G equivariant maps, or we also call them G homomorphisms. It's the same. That was the point. Then there is one fact that I will hopefully work out today later, that there is a formula for the character of HOM VW. I will show this with an explicit computation, not so beautiful, but anyway, and it is the value of the character conjugate on sigma times the value of the character. So it is, apart from this conjugation, it is the product of the, this is maybe in contrast to the character of a sum. If you take the direct sum of two representations, then the formula for the character of the sum is given by the sum of the characters. So this is sort of, Laura mentioned this, and it follows when you write down matrices. So this is the formula here. So then what I do, What I proved, that there was a lemma that gave a formula for the dimension of the space of invariance completely in general. This was equal to 1 over S sum sigma chi V of sigma. So this was a lemma that I proved last time. The proof is very easy. And now I will show you a corollary of this lemma is that we get a formula for the dimension of these of the group of G homomorphisms, because by this is equal to the invariance, so it is equal to the to this with the character equal to the character of the Hom VW space, which is equal to this. So this is equal to 1 over n sum over sigma in G of chi V of sigma times chi W of sigma. And this we recognize is precisely the scalar product of these two class functions. So we have a formula that expresses the dimension of the space of G invariant functions. It expresses it in terms of the characters. So if you know the characters of a representation, even if you do not know the representation, but only the characters, you can compute these dimensions. And now this immediately implies theorem 3. So let's prove theorem 3. Theorem 3 says that if two representations are isomorphic, the characters are the same, that is trivial, but the converse is interesting. If the characters are the same, then the representations are isomorphic. So I suppose that the characters are the same of two representations as functions, as class functions. And now I have my two representations. Now by theorem 2, I believe, every representation is a sum of irreducible representations, right? So V and V prime are a sum of irreducible representations. But there are only finitely many irreducible representations. So it may be that in such a sum, certain representations occur many times with a certain multiplicity. So I write it like this. I say V is the sum of VI to the NI, where the VI are irreducible, and the NI is the multiplicity. So this is all, this means VI to the NI means VI plus VI plus VI, or times VI if you like, NI times. So the NI is an integer at least zero. It can also be zero. And the same for V prime. This is the sum of VI to the MI. So this is irreducible and the MI are at least zero, okay? Now what is the character of chi V? Well, if you use this formula that the character of a sum is the sum of the characters, then the character of chi VI is simply the sum of the characters of these components. And the ith component occurs ni times. So this is equal to the sum over I of ni character of vi. And this is equal, chi v prime is equal to the sum over I mi chi vi. Yeah, we have this. Now I assume that the characters are the same. And what I do is I compute the scalar product of this character with these expressions. Yeah? So I compute So I compute the scalar product of the character of the representation with one of the chi vi's. Okay? Since the characters of the representations are the same by hypothesis, this is also equal to the character of vi, v prime, comma, vi. Right? Now this is equal. Now the scalar product is bilinear, so I substitute this formula and I get the sum over I of ni chi, or j chi j chi I, and here I get the sum of j mi chi j chi I. And now don't forget that all the chi i's and the chi j's are irreducible. And now I use the fact that the scalar product is the dimension of the space of G equivariant functions. And by Schur's lemma, between irreducible representations, this dimension is either 0 or 1. 1 if they are isomorphic, and otherwise it is 0. So now I use the formula said that chi I chi j is Hom, is the dimension of Hom G VI VJ, and I use Schur's lemma. And now what is the answer there? Well, all these scalar products vanish except one, the one for which I is equal to J, and then I get one. So this is NJ, NI, and this is MI. So you see that these exponents are the same. And that implies that these representations are the same, because I have the same, they're isomorphic. So the characters are able to see what the exponents are, and therefore they determine the representation. So it follows that Ni is Mi for all I, and that implies that V is isomorphic to V prime. So this proves theorem 3. This is theorem 3, end of proof. Now, theorem 4 then, I did already half of it. So theorem 4 says that the characters of the irreducible representations are an orthonormal basis. So the fact that they are orthonormal just says that the scalar product of chi vi and chi vj is equal to 0 if I is not j, and it is equal to 1 if I is j. But that is precisely the content of Schur's lemma, because this is this dimension. So that's okay because of Schur's lemma. So that shows that they are a set of independent vectors of length 1 that are orthogonal. What we have to show now is that the span is everything. So now the span of the chi vu I, so this is a subset of CG, and we want this to be equal. So what we want is equality. So what I do, I pick a function f in CG that is orthogonal to this subspace. Now if this is a proper inclusion, then I can find a vector here that is orthogonal to this space. And I want to show that the only possibility for such a function is 0. And then I have shown that this is equal. So I pick an f in CG that is orthogonal to this subspace. And that means it is orthogonal to each basis vector. So it is orthogonal to chi vu I for all I. And what I want to show it is that it is 0. Okay. So F. So I want to maybe I first. So what I want to prove, I want to show that F is identically 0. That implies then that these spaces are equal, and I'm done. So I can. So f is a function on G, no? So for every sigma, there is an f sigma. And you can in fact, moreover, it is a class function. So it is constant on conjugacy classes. And such a function, I can make it act. I can make it act on representations. So here's f acts on any G representation V. So how can I define my action? Well, I do as follows. I take a vector V in V, and I map it to the sum of F sigma sigma V. That is the action. And this action is actually is G equivariant. That means that multiplying, well, it means that because of the following, that if I, so what is equivariant? It means that if I multiply by tau here, and then I apply this, I get F sigma, sigma times V, I mean maybe sigma dot V, because this is the action on the representation space. So this is then a sigma, tau V. On the other end, if here I multiply by tau, I get the sum, I get the sum F sigma tau dot sigma V. Or maybe I put it here, tau. And maybe I put it all the way here. Why do I do so complicated? Let me. If I apply here tau, then I get tau times the sum of F sigma sigma times V. Now, why is this the same? This is the same because the tau commutes with the sum over F sigma sigma. And why is that? So tau and F, the sum of F sigma sigma, so both seen as operators on V, they commute. Why is that? Anyone sees it? So it commutes if as operators, tau times sum F sigma sigma is equal to sum F sigma sigma tau, right? That is the same. But I can bring the tau here. And then it's the same as tau sum F sigma sigma tau inverse. Maybe I put the tau also here. Tau tau inverse is equal to sum F sigma sigma. So why is that the same? Look, this is the conjugate of sigma. And so F sigma is equal to F tau sigma sigma tau inverse. And now I can make a change of summation variable and I get the same sum. So the point is that it is a class function. And that's why class functions are also called central functions, because they commute with all the others in this sense. Yeah, so they commute. This is the big thing. Okay. Now let's look, for instance, how f acts on the regular representation. You remember the regular representation V of reg? It was just a sum of vector space, one-dimensional vector spaces with basis E sigma, where sigma is in G. And how is the action of the group? G acts by multiplying the indices with group elements. So if I take a tau in G, then tau times E sigma is by definition E tau sigma. That is the definition. Thank you. Now I claim that this action on the regular representation is faithful. That means that f is, how do you say, f dot, the map from f to this operator is injective. So let me just write it, f acts faithfully. Let's see the words. Is it wet or something? So F acts. Yeah, it's very wet, sorry. So F acts faithfully on VREG. So that means that if F by accident, some F, which is in CG, acts as zero on the regular representation, then it actually is zero. Then f is the zero function. And that's very easy. Why is that? Well, look, I take, here's the proof. Take E1. One is the, so I take the neutral element of the group. Sigma is 1. Tau is 1. The neutral element of the group. I multiply it by f. So what does it do? Well, this is equal to the sum over sigma, f sigma, of sigma times this. But here I just multiply 1 by sigma, and I get e sigma, I get this. That's how it acts. But this is 0. What does it mean that this is 0? Well, in the regular representation, which is a vector space which has the e sigma as a basis, something like this is zero if and only if all the coordinates are zero. And that means that f is zero. Now, so to recall it, if I have an element, a central function or a class function, then I can act with it on representation. It's a beautiful action. It is G equivariant. And on the regular representation where it also acts, it acts faithfully. That means that if by accident it acts as zero, it is zero. It can only act as zero if it is already zero. No, as zero. As zero. Yeah? Okay, now I will. So that is good, because remember that I want to prove theorem 4. And in theorem 4, I took an F that was orthogonal to CG. This is what I want to prove. So I can prove it by letting it act. And now I do the following. So this is one example, the regular representation. Let's now look at an irreducible representation. Irreducible. So then again, f acts. Here also, the action is very beautiful. How does it act? How can it act? Well, of course, we know that by hypothesis, by assumption, I know that f is orthogonal to all the representations, all the irreducible representations. So f is orthogonal to the character of vi. So I know this. This is zero. So that means that the sum of chi vi sigma f sigma is zero. here is sigma in the group. Maybe I should put F bar here, F bar. Yeah? There is always something with the bar. You have to put it somewhere. Okay, we know this. Okay, so, but this we recognize. This is the lemma. This is also the so 1 over n maybe. This is 0. This is also the no, because F sigma, no, yeah. If I comp, so F x, it goes from vi to vi. Yeah? Let me compute what is the trace of F. So this is the trace on vi of F. Well, this is, by the lemma, precisely equal to this. It is equal, yeah, this is the trace. Yeah? And therefore the trace is 0. You see? This is the formula for the trace by the lemma. And this is 0. Or this is not the lemma, it is the statement after the lemma, the formula for the trace. This is 0. On the other hand, F is G equivariant. It is a G equivariant map between this irreducible representation and itself. And now we remember Schur's lemma. There are no such functions that are G equivariant between irreducible representations except scalars. So this means that F is actually some eigenvalue in C. It acts as a diagonal matrix, as a scalar matrix. But the trace is 0. So it is 0 as an operator on VI. So the fact that the trace is 0 and that it is scalar, this means that F acting on VI is 0. That's how it is. Can I? And now I'm done, because the regular representation is a sum of irreducible representations, of all irreducible representations. No, the regular representation is the sum of irreducible representations. And now I act with F, I go from the regular representation to the regular representation. That means I also go between the irreducible components. It is 0 there. So it is 0 on each VI. If you cannot go to another VI because of Schur's lemma, and if you go to VI itself, then it is also 0. So it is 0 on each VI, and therefore it is 0 acting. So F as an operator is 0, X is 0, and since the action is faithful, the only element that can act as 0 is 0 itself. The conclusion is that F is 0. And that completes the proof of theorem 4. So you cannot have elements that are orthogonal to all the characters, because then they act as 0 everywhere, because of this, of these formulas. Yeah? How much time do I have? 20 minutes, great. So let me then explain to you how you can compute the formula for the character of the homomorphism representation. So if you know about tensor products and duals of dual representations, then you just observe that HOM VW is canonically, in some sense, isomorphic to V dual tensor W. And you know what the character is on the tensor product. On the dual, you get the complex conjugate, and then you get exactly the formula. However, if you do not know this, and this doesn't mean much to you, there is also a direct way to compute it. So I will sketch to you how to do this. It is not very tasteful. Maybe you really want to learn about tensor products after you see the computation, but it can be done in a direct way. So let's say that V has a basis E1 up to E, what notation did I use? Yeah, N. I use the same notation because with the indices I'm afraid to make a mistake. So this is not the order of the group. This is the dimension. Let me call it D then, ED. And I have W, it also has a basis. Let's say it is E1 up to, or F1 up to F D prime. So the dimension of V is D, and the dimension of W is D prime. So what does it mean for the dimension of this space? It is the product, right? It is D times D prime. So the dimension of HOM VW is D times D prime. Now, if I want to compute the character of a representation is the trace of sigma is the trace of a matrix that describes the action by sigma, where sigma is an element in the group. And the trace, I can compute it if I have a basis. So I want to exhibit a basis of this space. So I need to exhibit D times D prime elements. So here's a basis. The basis is, it is a linear map. So I take delta ij to be the linear map that it is the linear map from V to W. So it is in here. And what does it do? It sends EI to FJ, and everything else is zero. So who knows what that looks like in terms of a matrix? So the matrix is a block D by D prime. So what does it look like, this one? It is almost entirely zero, right? Except in one place where it is one. In the ij coordinate, there is a one. This is also called an elementary matrix. So that's what the matrix looks like. You have everywhere zeros except in one spot, the ij spot, there is a one, and everything else is zero. That's what this looks like. So that's my basis. And now I'm going to compute the trace of some sigma. So I pick a sigma in G, and I act with sigma. Sigma then acts on V and it acts on W because they are G representations, no? So let me write. So sigma acts on V and sigma acts on W. So there is a matrix there. And on W, the matrix is B11, B1 D prime, B D prime 1, B D prime D prime. That is the matrix. And on V, it is actually more convenient to write down what is the matrix for sigma inverse. So that is then A11, A1D, or now it is more usual to do it the other way around, I think. So it is 1D prime. This is D1, A1D, ADD. Yeah, so I have a D by D matrix, which is the action by sigma inverse. And this is the action by sigma. And now I'm going to write down the representative matrix. Yeah, so now I get the map from, what is the map from HOM VW to HOM VW? That is the action by sigma that is it. So that is a huge matrix, DD prime by DD prime, and I want to know its trace. Yeah? So what happens here? Well, you remember the formula for the action on the home. The formula is, if V is in V, if I have an F, then sigma F applied to V. So if I have an F that goes to sigma F, then sigma F applied to V is by definition sigma dot F sigma inverse dot V. That's what it is. So what I do is I, and this is given by the matrix A. Let me call this matrix here A. And this is given by the matrix B. And so this is given by A and this is given by B. Yeah? So, and for F I take an element in my basis, which is delta ij I take delta ij, which is also a matrix, D by D prime. So what we have to do is compute. If I take V, I first take A, then I apply delta ij, and then I apply B. So I have to compute B, then the matrix delta ij, and then A. And what I do is I apply this to in order to see what this is, I apply it to an element V, which is EK. I take a basis vector in E. So take V as EK. And now you can compute what happens. So first I apply A, then I apply delta IJ, and then I apply B. Yeah? Now this is just the definition of a matrix multiplication. This is just multiply the kth vector in your basis with the matrix A. And the matrix A is here. So that is simply the sum k from 1 to n AKL EL. Okay. Who can compute the image now of this one? Can you read it? It all looks the same, but this is an E and this is an L. So where does this go? Who knows it? Bas knows it, but he cannot participate. Yeah. No, it's very easy. Look, what does delta J do? Delta J doesn't do almost anything. Look, it sends the ith vector to Fj and everything else to zero. So what does it do here? The ith vector is in the summation, and the rest I don't care, because it will go to zero. So I only look at the ith vector. And there the coefficient is aki. So it goes to aki fj. Yeah, that's what it is. It's very easy. And now I apply again the matrix B. And this is also easy. This is just matrix multiplication with one vector. And you get the aki, and then you get the sum. Let me erase this a little bit. Erase this a little bit, you get the BJR FR, where R runs from 1 to D prime. The N is D here. So this is the formula. EK goes here, goes there, goes there. Any EK in V, EK is a basis vector in V, goes to this expression. But you can express. So this is a sum of these delta functions, right? You can say, oh, this is actually EK goes to the AKI sum R from 1 to D prime BJR of delta KR applied to EK. That's what this is, right? Because that's what the deltas do. But I don't want a formula for one EK. I want a formula that works for all EK together. And then I have a matrix, and I can compute its trace. And who knows what would be a formula that works for all EK together. Anyone? You just take the sum. You take the sum of all these functions, because they are characteristic functions in some sense of one element at a time. So you just take the sum. Take the sum. And now we have the formula. So that is what sigma does with delta ij. If you apply sigma, it goes to this function that on ek does this, and the formula to have it for all is just the sum. I take the sum, k is 1 to d of sum, what is my summation index, r, r from 1 to d prime, a k j, b j r of delta, delta what? Delta f r. Is it f? K, delta k r, excuse me. Okay, now this is some huge matrix. In fact, it is D by D, you see, D by D prime matrix. Here are the coefficients. Now but this is only the image of one element. Now, if this matrix that I have, it has the delta EJs as basis, and on the diagonal, I find the coefficient that delta ij goes to some complicated formula, this one, but I only care about the one that is in the ij position to compute the trace. So I only care about the ij position. So this is something times delta plus the rest that I don't care about. The rest is here. And what is in the ij position? Well, I should take k equal to I, and I should take r equal to j. So this should actually be an I. I made a little mistake here. So what you get is aii bjj. That is what is here. And now if you take the sum over all ij's, you see that the trace is equal to the sum of the ai's times the sum of the BJJs. And this is precisely the trace of W, of sigma. And this is the trace of sigma inverse. But the trace of sigma inverse is the conjugate, because the eigenvalues are the inverses, but they are roots of unity, and therefore it is the conjugate. So this is the conjugate of the trace of sigma. Of V. And now we are done. I'm done. So learn tensor products. Okay? 5 minutes? 5 minutes? I want to do one exercise. It's the following in the last 5 minutes. It's about these home V W spaces. So if V and W are G representations, and this is also a G representation. And in some sense, on purpose, I did not give you examples of this because it is not so important. They play an important role in the proof, as you saw, but we didn't really see any examples. So I want to do one example with you. So here's an example. I take G to be S3, and I take V and W both equal to C3 with the usual permutation representation. Then I have this space. What is its dimension? 9. 3 times 3, right? So the dimension then is 9. So it is a 9-dimensional representation of S3. And we know that every representation is a sum of irreducible representations. And we know the irreducible representations of S3. There is the identity, there is epsilon, the sign, and there is rho, this two-dimensional irreducible representation. Remember on the hyperplane where the coordinates are equal to, sum of the coordinates equal to 0. Let me call these representations V1, V epsilon, and V rho. So then we know that this representation is isomorphic to V1 to a certain power, N1, plus V epsilon to a certain power, N2, plus V rho to a certain power, N rho, where the N1, N2, and N rho are integers. And how can we compute these integers? Well, you saw that in the proof, right? So the integers are given by computing scalar products. For instance, N1 is the scalar product of the trivial character with the character of this representation. And the same for N2 or N epsilon, maybe I call it N epsilon. N epsilon, N rho, you can compute similar scalar products. But that is nice, but then I need to know what is the character of this homomorphism representation. Oh, but that we saw. We saw that the character of the homomorphism representation of sigma is equal to chi v of sigma times chi bar v of sigma. Because in this example, v is equal to w, which is the absolute value squared of this complex number. And we know the character of V. You remember the character of V is the whole space. So it permutes the coordinates. So what is the trace of 1? And what is the trace of 1, 2? And what is the trace of 1, 2, 3? Well, Laura computed those for you. 1 is the identity matrix. It has trace 3, this has 1 fixed point, it has trace 1, and this has trace 0. So this is equal to 9 if sigma is 1, it is 1 if sigma is 1, 2, and it is 0 if sigma is the other one, 1, 2, 3. So we can compute the length of this character, the length square. It is 9 square, or 1/6 of 9 square, and 1 square, but there are 3 2 cycles. So it is 3 times 1 square. Here you find your mistakes always extremely quickly, because if I had forgotten the 3, then there was 82 here. And 82 is not divisible by 6, and these lengths are always integers. So there must be the 3 here. Now I have 84, and this is actually 14. So this is not irreducible, because irreducible characters always have length 1. This is a sum of a bunch of irreducible representations, just as I wrote here. Now let's compute 1 coefficients, and then I let you. So what is this scalar product? Well, it's 1/6 times 9 plus, no, because here is always 1, no? Chi 1 is 1, 1, 1. So it is 9 plus 3 times 1 times 1 plus 0. And this is 12 divided by 0. Again, we get an integer, as we should, and this is 2. So I know that this index is 2. The trivial representation appears 2 times. And for those of you that like these kind of computations, as I do, they are really fun. And so you can prove so that n epsilon is 1, and n rho is 2. Is that right? Or is it 3? How much should it be? This is already three-dimensional, this is nine-dimensional, n row is three. So you can compute these multiplicities by computing scalar products in CG. So now we know a little bit what this representation is. It is a product of these irreducible representations. Okay, thank you very much.